Okay, so let's begin with a word of prayer. Father, we thank you that we're here. We pray, dear God, that you guide our conversation. We thank you for just the blessing that we have, Lord, of being able to look into your word. We thank you for your Holy Spirit who guides us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So you were saying the question?
Yeah. So you said not everything in the Bible is from God.
Yes.
Right? But God inspires, I can't think of a better word, right?
Yes.
Inspires, yes. Or the Holy Spirit inspires these people to write that.
Mm-hmm.
So isn't it, in a sense, from God? I
yes.
know the devil speaks,
mm-hmm.
right? But and I guess when I think about life in general, I know that God permits everything. So nothing mm. happens without God saying yes.
Yeah.
So for me, everything in the Bible is permitted by God in the sense that
yeah.
He prompted these people or used these individuals to write it down. So mm. isn't he above all, in control of all?
Well, yes. Well, yes and no. Yes, in the sense that yes, it's the Word of God, and you know the Bible says, first of all, I don't believe that the Bible is written mechanically. Because then we would all have one vocabulary. Then when I'm reading John, I would have no problem because I read Paul and I'll say, oh yeah, I see. But they're different languages, different ways of expressing themselves. They're different from Isaiah. So the personality of the person is still there. So I look at things as they are. And as we see is that God, you know, in 2 Peter says that the Holy Spirit led them. And the imagery there is of a boat out in the water and the wind blows and it's guiding. So as they're writing, the Holy Spirit is making sure that what they're bringing down ultimately is from God. But now, when you're writing a history, and you're writing what happened, you're simply telling what occurred. And so the Holy Spirit is guiding in the direction. Doesn't mean that simply because it historically occurred, it becomes a paradigm for how we're supposed to live. So there are many things you find in the Bible that are just written
wait,
down because
wait,
it was...
that it doesn't become a paradigm?
No. For example, I'll give you an example. When people talk about contradiction in the Bible, in one of the books, I think it's the end of 1 Samuel or the end of 2 Samuel, it says that Saul killed himself. He fell on his sword. And then in the next book that you read, it says somebody comes and claims that they killed Saul. Now, all that's happening is it's telling a historical thing of what happened. Saul did kill himself. The Holy Spirit had written that. But the Holy Spirit also had written down that somebody came trying to claim, like, hey, get some reward. Like, hey, I killed Saul. But it's just a historical. Does it mean it's a contradiction? No, it means that the Holy Spirit just got him to historically write down what occurred. And that becomes part of our instructions in the Word of God. So it teaches us about things. But we have to know that when the guy is claiming to have killed Saul, that he's lying. And that doesn't mean the Bible is telling us condoning lying and trying to take credit for something we didn't really do. Obviously not. But it's there as an example maybe of not lying and being honest in what you do. But yeah, there are places in the Bible where, for example, Satan is speaking. And we should never take those passages as formative and guiding us on how we should live. Again, when I do my hermeneutics, I'm very cautious. Well, having studied the Bible for so long, I know, for example, when I see people developing their theology, let's say from the book of Acts, I know they're in trouble. I know they're in trouble because it's a historical book. It's not a didactic book. It's not a book teaching you like Romans, which is teaching you, or Ephesians teaching you. It's a book written specifically to tell you what happened. Doesn't mean necessarily it has to happen all the time. Doesn't mean that Acts chapter 5, you know, two people lied to the Holy Spirit, they drop dead. Doesn't mean every single person lies to the Holy Spirit from that point on will drop. Otherwise, there'd be a lot of casualties in the church. That just became an example of something, you know, setting a pattern of what is wrong and not to do this, but not that every single person after that happens to them, or that every single time somebody lies to the Holy Spirit, there's a possibility they might just struck down and die because somebody's going to come and tell them. So you have to be careful where you're getting your stuff from. That's why when I develop my theology, I want to make sure that it's not just found in one little passage somewhere, but that it's everywhere, that it's in many places. You know, when I'm reading the Psalms, I know it's poetry. I know it's poetic. It's like listening to a song on radio. You know, when I hear a song that says, you know, drive by, you know, what is it, drive by love, whatever, you know, drive by shooting love, whatever it is that song says. I don't really think that the guy really believes that he loves her the way, you know, gunning her down. He's using an imagery of what he feels to express his passion, his love, whatever. So when I'm reading Psalms, I read them as poetry. So again, if you try to build a theology based upon the Psalms, you might have a very weird theology. Like I said a few weeks ago, you know, it's about taking out that Holy Spirit from me. If you don't know the context of what that means, and what David is speaking about, you're going to really believe that God can take his Holy Spirit from you. That because you went out and committed a sin, God's going to take the Holy Spirit away from you. And that's not what it means. So again, knowing the context is very important, knowing the kind of literature it is. That's why I say, you know, great books. Again, see, I lead you to books. That's what I do. Great books to read, Gordon D. Fee, you know, and Douglas Stewart, How to Read the Bible for What It's Worth, which deals with the genres, the different types of literature found in the Bible, because that's how I read them. But yeah, so yeah, the Holy Spirit put it in there, permitted it in there, but it's not inspired from God in the sense that this is what the Lord wants to instruct you about. Obviously, the friends of Job are wrong. And if we follow their counsel, we're wrong. Their whole point of them being there is because they are presenting a theology that's contrary to the truth of God. And so if we were to quote them and say, Zophar said, well, Zophar is wrong.
Well, Zophar is wrong because Job taught him wrong, though.
That's right. Well, you say that's because you studied a little further there, a little cutting there. Yeah, you're right, because they acknowledge that he was the one who taught them originally. He was the teacher. Job had instructed these men on this theology, and his theology was wrong. And God had to come and correct his theology, and he does in a very radical way. But yes, his theology is wrong because Job instructed him. But now we know it's there. But we can't quote Zophar and say, see, this the Lord says. Because no, that's not what the Lord is saying. That's just a historical document. We have to be careful what, you know. Now, if you're doing Elihu, who comes in at the end, just before God confronts Job directly, there you can say, no, this guy is on the money. He is expounding the theology that's going to lead right into God stepping in, and he doesn't get rebuked at the end for anything because he was right. He was already correcting Job on his mistakes, preparing the stage for God showing up and saying, who is this? You know. But again, but even if we have differing points of view on different issues like that, that should not, like I said, the core has to be what we know about Christ. I mean, I do tend to be a little more pedantic, like when recently we were talking about this guy, Bill Johnson. You know, I was listening to more of his stuff. Some of his stuff sounds so cool, so right on the money, very solid. And then it just goes off. And I'm like, but that going off to me is so radical that it's like we should be cautious. So even if we listen to it, we should have discernment in what we're listening to. I remember when I was younger, I would listen to, not that young because I already knew my Greek. I would listen to Kenneth Copeland because somebody was into Kenneth. And this is what I do. Come into Kenneth Copeland, I was listening to Kenneth Copeland. But I stood there with my Bible open to the passage he was in. And he started out fine. He was going through the passage in Galatians. So I was like, cool. You know, I was like, bang. He goes off in this tangent. Nowhere near the text. He's not quoting anything anymore. He's not even saying, well, back in Isaiah, nothing. He's just on a tangent that has nothing to do with what Paul says in Galatians. So again, I follow them. I listen to them. You know, and that's like I was listening to a guy in the end times. And I told you, he was talking. And he's appropriately skipped verses that would dismantle what he had been saying. I was waiting for him to come to those verses. So I'm there waiting patiently. He stops, he pauses, talks about something other. Yeah. Here's the rabbit. And, you know, at least for me. I mean, for me, you see, I'm cynical that way. It was like you just distracted them, and now you lead them back, and you've skipped about four or five verses that will nail you down, you know?
I do. I feel when I listen, because sometime in the morning, I'll listen to different pastors. And most of the time when they start reading a verse, I may not know verbatim what came just before it, because I always pay attention. I'm like, what came before it?
Yeah.
What's coming after it? And then they stop and they go to, let's go to this other passage. And I'm like, wait, are those two connected? Mm-hmm. Like, how are they connected? Mm-hmm. And, okay. Yeah. All right.
See, like, look, which is what I wanted to start with today, because somebody had mentioned a comment about one of my recordings. You know, last week I had mentioned about the fact that my concern with Messianic churches. And again, I believe they're evangelical. I believe they're born again. It's not like I don't think they're not Christian. I just think we need to be cautious that we don't get back into a sense of thinking that we need to follow the law in order to be saved, or that a Gentile has to become a Jew in order to be accepted by God. This is ludicrous. Once you get to that point, you're contradicting the gospel. Now you're becoming heretic. But everybody has those points of view. Everybody has those things. I was mostly looking into Jonathan Kahn because the young man who's on Facebook with me is from that congregation. So I'll view the video. When he puts videos of Jonathan Kahn, I'll listen. And I've gone to YouTube and listened to Jonathan Kahn. And Jonathan Kahn does the same thing I do. And to me, he goes even more radically, because he was talking about the Israel and the church, and he was talking to Jim Baker, of all people. If you don't know Jim Baker, okay, go Google that. And I'm thinking, why are you being interviewed by this guy to begin with? But, okay, besides that, one of the interviews, because he has numerous interviews with Jim Baker, he talks about the church in Israel. He says, those who believe that the church replaces Israel are simply the old liberal churches that are dying. This is his explanation of what replacement theology is about. This is what he summarizes, people who hold to replacement theology. We're from the old liberal churches that are dying, because now they see that, of course, that's not true. And that Israel has her function and the church has her function, and they're both equally the people of God. And no, that's not true. And he completely misrepresented. He can say whatever he pleases. But what I'm saying is that people do express their own point of view. I'm only expressing my point of view. And I challenge you, go check it out. I'll send you the YouTube link where he says this. So there's no issue for me there. You have to study the Word of God, know what it really says, and keep questioning, keep asking, keep going. And if something doesn't sound right, you know, like there are passages in the Bible to me that I'm not completely, they frustrate me. And maybe from some people, they'll be like, well, I can't believe that's the one that frustrates you. Like, I'm frustrated with 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and end of chapter 1 all the way to chapter 3. I'm frustrated with it because I'm trying to figure out exactly what Paul is referencing. And to me, it's like, is he talking about the sophist? Is he talking about something else? Is he talking about the stoic? What is he talking about? Who is he confronting when he's talking about this wisdom of this world, wisdom of this age? What does he mean? And for me, I'm not settled yet, not convinced yet that this is it. So I keep studying, keep looking. And maybe one day someone's going to say something, I'm going to go, now, finally, there's a man who can connect all the pieces. Now, to me, that's what N.T. Wright has done so well when it comes to Romans. Because he has studied Romans, and this is what he did his PhD on. And he looked at the whole picture first, and then he started putting it all together. Now, he's blessed because he lives after what's called the Sanders Revolution of 1977. The guy who finally wrote a book said, you know what, you guys, Christians have misunderstood the Pharisees. You don't know what you're talking about. Here's the score. And set the scholarly world going in the right direction to really study the New Testament context and say, really, you know, you're looking at the New Testament, you're studying it from a 16th century context. You're looking through the eyes of Luther and Calvin rather than through the eyes of Paul. And great revolutionary guy. And yet I don't agree with his theology. You know, I think he's wrong. But he's right about that. But that's why we have to keep looking into it. And it was funny because one of the critiques that Jonathan Cahn got, which I thought was humorous, I thought was like, so, you know, it was like, when he wrote The Harbinger, where he talks about prophecies in Isaiah, and he believes that they have been replayed or re-fulfilled in the history of America. And someone called him a replacement theologian. Because how can you take the prophecies of Israel and apply them to the nation of America as if they were the people of God? And I thought, finally, somebody got him. Because I thought, when I do it, I think I'm doing it biblically. When I say the church is the people of God, and look all the names and titles given to them, the same name titles as Israel, I'm being called a replacement theologian. He calls America the chosen nation of God, and somehow he's okay. And I'm like, where in the Bible say, and I will call George Washington, and he will lead my people? No, really. Think about it. There's no place in the Bible where America is spoken of as a nation specifically chosen by. That's an opinion. Nowhere in the Bible are you going to go and say, see, Zechariah chapter 2, verse 5, it says, America will rise up as my new chosen people. Then never. It's only one chosen people. That's the people of Israel. And in my opinion, that's still the only people because we are Israel. It has not changed. It's not gone from Israel to somebody else. It is Israel. Only now we know how to better define Israel, who the real Israel is, which is what Paul is doing here in chapters 9 to 11. Any questions?
I think you'll find the thing about America in G2.
Oh, I find I put on John Hagee and I'm like, that's all I hear. I put on John Hagee and I'm like, I'm in a history American history class. But I'm being told that Israel's the chosen people, and church chosen people, and America's chosen people. A lot of chosen people out there, you know? But there are very patriotic people who are wrong, who are just sincere Christians who are sincerely wrong. America is not a chosen nation. The church are the chosen people of God who live in America and all around the world as well. Wherever the body of Christ is, that's where God is. That's where the Spirit of God is. But any other questions? All right, that's good. Let's jump into our text. Romans 11. Whoa, we made it to the great chapter. Dun, dun, dun.
Hold on.
See?
I'm sorry. This morning...
No need to apologize. Unless you do something wrong first.
I was listening to Romans. I just plugged in my headphones and I just started playing from Romans 10. So I was like...
The greatest hits.
And it said about election, God choosing... Oh, is it Jacob and someone who was pregnant? And Esau I hate and Jacob I love.
Yeah, that was chapter 9.
Chapter 9, okay, that's where it started. And I was wondering about that. And for some reason, I started thinking about Calvinists? Arminians?
Yeah.
Calvinists. Come on, Pastor. 9-1.
Oh, it's right after 9-6. 9-6, which is not always residual, so it's right after that.
9-6. But it talked about God elected someone, was it?
Yeah, verse 11. Even before they had been born or had done anything good or bad, so that God's purpose of election might continue, not by works, but by his call, she was told the elder should serve the younger.
All right, so God's purpose of election, based on the fact that he knew that who would say yes?
Nothing to do at all with that. Absolutely nothing at all to do with
it. So did I mess up there?
See, that's why the lessons have to be repeated over and over again, because what I'm saying is dealing with the text, not with a Calvinist issue or Arminian issue. This
no,
has to do
when,
with.
When I
this
heard
has to,
it, that for some reason those
this is
two came
who
to mind.
Are the people of God? And he begins by saying Isaac and Ishmael to say that it's not genealogical, it's by faith. It's not because you're from the line of Abraham that you are a child of God or child of faith. It is by faith. Secondly, he says Jacob and Esau to show that it's not by works of the law, what Jews would distinguish themselves as. But rather, again, by faith, not by works. That's why it's before they had done anything, because the belief in Judaism was that Jacob was faithful, was considered righteous because he was obeying the law, even before the law existed. You know, again, by deeds. And Paul says, no, it's not by deeds. It's not by genealogy. It's by faith. This is how we're saved. So who are the people of God? You know, the Jews cannot say, oh, it's because we are biologically from Abraham, or because we are the ones who follow Torah. Torah was given to us. He says, no. And he shows the distinctions. That's how it breaks down. If you want, I'll pass on the notes to you when I dealt with that, because I was trying to deal with it extensively, because I know it's like a headache, because, like I told you, you'll listen to it, and then no sooner do you listen to it, you walk outside, and again, you're like, oh, yeah, it's predestination. But again, what Paul's answering in chapter 9 to chapter 11 is, who is Israel? Who are the people of God? Keep that in mind. That's what he's trying to answer. He's not trying to answer who's predestined, who's going to heaven. This is not his point. His point is, you know, again, who are the real people of God? Let me see if I find the exact quote for...
And then the one about the potter and the clay, if a potter makes... I must have missed that class because I have no...
You see, in the notes, I explained that in Hebrew tradition, Jacob was one who followed Torah. Esau did not follow Torah. So he did not follow the works of the law. And therefore, that's why he once considered righteous, not the other. And Paul says, no, has nothing at all to do with that. You know, has to do, again, with God and being faithful to God and believing in God. You know, you're saved by faith. Again, the potter and the clay, I took you back to Jeremiah. Go to Jeremiah 18. That's where Paul's referencing. And the whole passage there talks about how God was seeking to form Israel, but Israel rebelled. Pottery does not rebel. It shows that it's an image. And so, even though you rebelled, I'm still going to work with you and make out of you what I want. You know, so that even though I cannot get from you what I want, which of course you were supposed to be the light of nations, you're supposed to bring salvation, you have rebelled, you've done wrong, but I'm still going to use you for my purposes, which of course is going to lead to salvation of the Gentiles. But again, he's going to still mold, he's going to have a purpose for them, even if it's not the purpose that he had intended, what he wanted for them. Again, God wants intent. He wanted Israel to be a certain way. They did not. They rebelled. He uses he hardens them to then accomplish the work that he wants done.
Okay, Jeremiah, where?
Jeremiah 18.
All right,
I should just put. I should have just send you all my notes. Seriously.
I wasn't here for those two classes. I was like, wait a second. What did we just?
But again, I'm telling you, as soon as you listen to his stuff, and you go and you turn on TV and you listen to their preachers, you would think this has nothing to do at all with who is Israel, or this is what Paul, you would think that Paul's talking about predestination. This is the farthest thing from Paul's mind, because first of all, for a Jew, there's no such issue. Again, for a Jew, they think I am already predestined because I'm a Jew. I am born elect. They're born elect. You know, they don't believe that they're, and that's what Paul also has to demolish that. No. You're not saved. You're not made right with God simply because you're a Jew. You have to have faith. This is the means by which God has chosen that people will be right with him. Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Not that Abraham followed Torah, or simply because Abraham's a Jew. Abraham is technically really the first Jew, because he's really Babylonian. And we already went through that ground. But again, you have to keep going back over and over again. And I counsel you. N.T. Wright, of course, does it in this book. But if you want to go deeper into that, read N.T. Wright. Read what book would be good to read by N.T. Wright? Where he deals. He has a number of books. But he recently wrote a book where he collected all the essays that he had written on Paul from 1978 till 2000 something. It's called. Call something or other.
Is it New Testament theology?
No. Again, N.T. Wright writes is worth worth reading, but there are a number of books that are easier. Probably the better place to start with that is see if I find them. It's A New Perspective on Paul. I think it's called A New Perspective on Paul. Paul in Fresh Perspective. And that's the one that I gave you the essay from that I copied once about the three worlds of Paul. That's the book that comes from.
That essay is good but confusing.
Yeah, well, you know, all good stuff is confusing. Yeah, he's not.
Yep. Paul in Fresh Perspective.
There it is.
Yeah.
Paul Fresh Perspectives.
Yeah. But actually, you know, the rule should be simple. This is when it comes to Pauline stuff. Whatever N.T. Wright wrote, read it. It's worth it. It really is. Again, the first one that he came out with was Climax of the Covenant, which is just too difficult to really take in. That's why I think Paul in Fresh Perspective is good. And again, he wrote a bunch of essays, which is just a huge book on how his thoughts developed on the theme of Abraham, this, that, you know, and he brings all those things there. Not as much dealing with this issue I told you before, A. Chadwick Thornhill, that's the book. What's the name of the book? Paul, Election, and the Second Temple Judaism.
That
is the book. And he has the, and I emailed you the PhD that he wrote on it. It's all coming back to me now.
You said to read his dissertation. You said The Chosen People?
Yes.
Is that the same book? Or
A. Chadwick Thornhill?
Yeah.
Yes.
The Chosen People.
That's it.
Okay.
That's the one he wrote. And that one, but his PhD is actually online. And it's much more thorough. And in there he deals extensively with the whole Isaac and Ishmael, Jacob. Actually, I agree more with him than I do with N.T. Wright. N.T. Wright does not go in deeply into that and makes the same distinctions that this guy makes. I agree more with him to show you that I'm just not an N.T. Wright fan. This guy, I think, nails it on the head. He really shows that this is really what's going on in this passage.
Mm-hmm. What's it called? What's the author?
A. Chadwick Thornhill. And he's one of those very despicable guys who's not only very scholarly, but he's actually one of those things, like he's an American Warrior thing, where he does all those physical things.
Oh, okay. American
Warrior.
I see him, he does those videos, I'm like, oh, that's disgusting. That's not right. That's just not right. You should be like a big fat man sitting somewhere. You know. What are you doing?
Real quick, do you, because I have it here, but I don't have the author. It's an essay. It's called Does God Love Everyone?
That's Jerry Walls. That's a fantastic little book. Unfortunately, $15 for like a very little book, but hopefully it'll get cheaper and cheaper as time goes by. Yeah, when you buy like $15, like, oh, it's not expensive. And they're like, oh, yeah, it's expensive.
It's that expensive.
Trees.
That's why you always have to wait for book sales. That's why on Facebook, you guys don't see that lately. I put like, you know, the Zondervan had a whole thing on N.T. Wright books for like $4.99 on Kindle. Nobody caught that. I just posted that.
No, my Kindle is dead, so I'm not buying anything for Kindle. Yeah.
But, so you can get them cheaply that way if you want to read N.T. Wright.
Did we went over 20 and 21 last week? Because I thought we stopped at 19.
We did 19 to 21, I think.
Yeah, we did it.
No, 21.
Yeah, we did it.
Okay.
So let's start chapter 11, verses 1 through 10. Sian, would you read that for us?
1 through 10, sir?
Yes, please.
I asked them, did God reject his people? By no means. I am an Israelite myself, a descendant of Abraham from the tribe of Benjamin. God did not reject his people whom he foreknew. Don't you know what scripture says in the passage about Elijah? How he appealed to God against Israel? Lord, they have killed your prophets and torn down your altars. I am the only one left and they are trying to kill me. And what was God's answer to him? I have reserved for myself 7,000 who have not bowed to the knee, have not bowed the knee to Baal. So too at the present time, there is a remnant chosen by grace. And if by grace, then it cannot be based on works. And if it were, grace would no longer be grace. What then? What the people of Israel sought so earnestly, they did not obtain. The elect among them did, but the others were hardened, as it is written. God gave them a spirit of stupor, eyes that could not see and ears that could not hear to this very day. And David says, may their table become a snare and a trap, a stumbling block and a retribution for them. May their eyes be darkened so they cannot see and their backs be bent forever.
Verse 11 also.
Oh, sorry. Again I ask, did they stumble so as to fall beyond recovery? Not at all. Rather, because of their transgression, salvation has come to the Gentiles to make Israel envious.
Okay. Actually, you're right, it was 10. any initial questions? Again, we see, again, just Paul hammering it once again, the remnant. There's just, if anybody walks, that's why I'm just shocked that by the time we get to the end of this chapter, people are going to say, oh, Israel gets saved. It's just like, dude, why would this guy keep saying only a remnant, and then at the end say, you know, I'm wrong. I just had a revelation. Here he quotes from all three segments of the Old Testament. He quotes from the Torah, he quotes from the prophets, and he quotes from the writings. In verses 1 and 2, Paul points to the fact that he is from the tribe of Benjamin. Now, this is important because, well, first of all, it's one of the few tribes that people could actually trace their lineage to because it was from the southern kingdom. Not anymore, of course. I mean, anybody who tells you they can trace themselves back to the tribe of so-and-so, yeah, it's a tribe of guessing, because all the records were destroyed. But up to this point, the southern kingdom did last, and the southern kingdom did keep their records for the longest. So people from the tribe of Judah, from Benjamin, tribes like that, they knew who they were, where they came from. But Paul's point is, of course, is not to talk about his lineage. His point is primarily to say, look, of course God has not given up on the Jews. I am a Jew. You know, we mean, of course Jews are getting saved. I got saved. And I'm an apostle to the Gentiles. But yeah, you know, so this he's like, you know, showing himself as like proof that God is working among the Jews, that there is salvation there, that it's not, you know, that it's not, oh my goodness, God has forgotten about the Jews. He only cares about Gentiles. Only Gentiles are getting saved. Of course not. And, of course, he quotes 1 Samuel 12:22, where it says God has not rejected his people whom he foreknew. No, God is not through with his with ethnic Israel. The difference is, how are they saved? How do they come to salvation? How do they become part of the covenant people of God? And again, he goes right back into the issue of the remnant. Now, Paul identifies himself with Elijah here in this passage. You know, again, when he's quoting this about Elijah, it's not like, oh, why? It's just, you know, just giving like, it's like he's a pastor giving a biblical illustration. Remember Elijah? No, he's saying, I am like Elijah. And I'm living among the Jews who have demolished things of God, who are worshiping the Baals, and they won't turn to God. And I'm crying out to God, God, why is this happening? God is saying to me, no, there's still a remnant left. Again, taking it back to the theme of remnant. But he takes it to Elijah and shows that even in the time of Elijah, not all Israel was Israel. Most of the Israelites were following after Baal. They were worshiping false gods and doing things wrong. But there were 7,000 Israelites who had not bowed the knee to Baal, who were being faithful to Yahweh. And he says, that's my people. Those are the faithful ones. That is Israel. That's the remnant. Again, bring us back to that situation of who really are the people of God. But again, they're saved by grace, not by works. They're chosen not because of the works of law. And again, he doesn't mean by works of law, it means the badge of honor that the Israelites had. It's not because they had the law and it was their possession. It was because they knew that salvation was by grace. It's always been by grace. Nobody can ever turn to God and say, you owe me. I deserve. Not even Abraham. God is the one who always graciously offers and gives salvation to us. The only thing that we can do is what Abraham did. Believe. Trust God. Listen to him. But you cannot earn it. And this becomes the focal point again, once again for Paul. Any questions? What then? What the people of Israel sought so earnestly, they did not obtain. But listen to this. The elect among them did. But the others were hardened. Yes, those who were that believed by faith, yes, they were saved among Israel. The rest were hardened. But again, we'll see that hardened is not a detrimental thing. Just because you're hardened doesn't mean you cannot be unhardened, that you cannot eventually repent. Hardened is a temporary condition, and you can eventually repent. But the hardened comes because of their disobedience. God sends the message, they refuse to believe. God says, is that what you want? You got it. And then he hardens them so they get their punishment. But then he allows them to see if they will repent, and he calls them back. Will you now listen? Will you not come back?
He hardens them, or he just steps back and let them walk deeper into their...
No, he hardens them. He just doesn't simply let them go. There are passages where God lets people go into their own demise. Here, it's like, no, he hardens. Meaning, for example, which is same thing with Pharaoh. Exactly. But again, Pharaoh was not detrimental. It was a hardening for a time to serve a purpose. Once that purpose is served, the hardening is released. So what God does is, and we'll see in the next section that we deal with, is that God hardened Israel, not because he wanted to make them disobedient. Because they were disobedient, he hardened them for the purpose of getting the gospel to the Gentiles. Once that's accomplished, now the hardening is removed. Now you still have a chance to repent. So even in chapter 7, we saw that God saying to Israel, how long have I have reached out to my hands to a disobedient and, you know, stubborn people? Now, he can't do that if they cannot repent. He would be a hypocrite to say it to them. Oh, how I wish you would turn to me, you know. Yeah, that would be ludicrous if they can't do it. No, they're only hardened for a season to accomplish a purpose of God. And then, once that's accomplished, he gives them the opportunity again. Will you now listen to me? Will you now repent? And that's what he does. We'll see that closer when we deal with the Isaiah passage. Any question? N.T. Wright writes at this point, says, Paul is drawing on the Jewish tradition that runs like this. When God delays outstanding judgment, those who do not use this time of delay to repent and turn back to him will be hardened. so that their final judgment when it comes will be seen to be just. Again, he hardens them, you know, because they refuse to obey. But he gives them then a time to repent. If they don't, then of course, then the final judgment comes, and then it's all over. And one of the notorious passages that always came up was the passage from Isaiah about, you know, having eyes they do not see. You know, verse 8, look at verse 8. God gave them a spirit of stupor, eyes that could not see, and ears that could not hear to this very day. When this spirit of stupor, of course, comes from the Lord. And God says, basically, you won't listen to me. You won't obey me. He solidifies them in their disobedience. You know, and on the contrary, he sends prophets for that very reason, to condemn them for their behavior and to bring judgment down on them. But again, he does eventually relent. Yes. Go.
Actually, is that the same as an evil spirit? Because I was reading 1 Samuel today, and I came upon this where he said, this is 1 Samuel 19,
yeah.
But an evil spirit from the Lord came on Saul.
Yes.
Is that like hardening?
Well, I think that's even worse, because he really gave up on Saul there. But the evil spirit, again, it's not, the stupor is definitely from the Lord directly intervening. I would say the spirit that comes upon Saul is a demonic spirit. And he's being given, and God is allowing, and God is sending him to do that task. But of course, in the Old Testament, they don't call it demonic, they just call it a spirit from the Lord. But I don't believe it's an actual, the evil spirit does not belong to God.
That's why, when I read that,
it's that God controls everything. Just like, you know, when Satan comes and says, I want to hit Job. I say, okay, you can do it.
Oh.
But God, of course, somebody's going to affect Saul, and God says to that spirit, go right ahead. You know,
and he does
work through that, to that evil spirit. But again, you see, there's a good analysis of what David was praying about. Take not the Holy Spirit from me. Because he knows what happened to Saul. The Spirit of God left Saul, and an evil spirit came upon Saul. And he's saying, don't take your anointing from me. Don't take the kingship away from me. It has nothing to do with salvation. Not like, David's saying, I don't want to lose my salvation. He's saying, no, I don't want to be like Saul. I don't want to have you dash my kingship into a ground because of my moral failures, just like his moral failures. He says, you know, and of course, God doesn't.
So, is this still occurring in today? So the people, when in their disobedience to God, they just refuse to hear anything in the Word of God when brought to them. So now, are their hearts, like, is it possible that their hearts are hardened by the Lord, and then, say you continuously, you're still trying to, like, you know, evangelize to that person who's been just, like, not listening, who just lives a sinful life, you know? Is it possible that it's, why it's so difficult is because their hearts are hardened, and that there will be a time, though, where it's just, like, you see everything click, and you're just like, why didn't you think of that before? And was it because, like, this just, it wasn't going to happen before?
Is that possible? Okay. Possible. I mean, I wouldn't want to speculate on it, maybe. But yes, of course, God has not changed his ways of working. But we've seen two things already in the book of Romans. We've seen in the beginning where God hands people over to their sinfulness. You know, this is primarily the language of the Gentiles. Gentiles did not have the Holy Spirit. They did not have the covenant of God. They did not have all these things. So God hands them over to their immorality, to their evil, to their sinfulness. The hardening is mostly used for Israel. But yes, I would agree that, yeah, there are people that God is gracious to them. God sends all these things to them. And rather than repenting, they don't listen to God. And God then judges them. And like Paul already said in Romans 2, and he's going to say again in Romans again, later on he's going to say, God's kindness is given to you, so you repent. But if you don't repent, all you're doing is storing up wrath, and here comes judgment. But yes, God can harden. But when God does harden in the Bible, it's for a purpose.
Yeah.
You know, again, let's say, you know, he wants to accomplish something in your life, and, you know, he's going to use somebody else to do it. He's going to harden them in some way to maybe oppose you, whatever, and that will stimulate you to do whatever you have to do, and then God relents, just like he did to Pharaoh. He hardened Pharaoh. But again, the hardening of Pharaoh was not, oh, just Pharaoh was just some sweet Pharaoh just sitting there playing the harp, and God was such a mean-spirited God, just hardened him. Pharaoh was evil. Pharaoh hardened his heart against God. Pharaoh was disobedient. Moses came and told him, and he said, no, I'm not going to let you go, and he hardened his heart. And then when he's finally ready to relent, God's like, oh, okay, you're ready to relent, but I'm not ready to finish my job. I still have a lot of things I want to show through you, so I'm now going to harden you. But again, the words that he uses there in the Old Testament are temporal words. They're not a hardening that is persistent, like forever. It's for a time, a hardening. And same thing with Israel. They will harden for a time. Can God do it today? Of course he can. Yeah.
Wouldn't that raise the question of when you tell people that, you know, to seek after the Lord and, you know, to truly, like, search for him, and those people say that they're searching, they're reading the word, they're trying to pray and all these things, and nothing comes of it. Wouldn't they say, like, if they understand that God, you know, he hardened the heart of Pharaoh when he wanted to go and, like, I guess, be with God in a sense, you know, when he was ready, you know, the Lord's like, mm-hmm. you know, like, the purpose is not done mm-hmm. yet. So now in like today's world, you know, that same thing, the question would be raised, like, as how is that fair to me if I want to go mm-hmm. to him? And it's just like, no, your heart will be hardened now for a purpose nonetheless. And then,
but I would make distinction of salvation. Mm-hmm. I think if Pharaoh said, you know, I'm ready to become a believer. I'm ready to accept your path, Yahweh. Mm. That you are the true God. I don't see God would harden him at that point. Mm. He has no conviction of becoming a believer or following the ways of Yahweh.
Okay.
He's being hardened to accomplish a historical purpose for things of God. I don't think, again, if a person starts actually trying to read the Bible in prayer, I would think, well, you don't sound too hardened.
Yeah, exactly.
Because if you were really hardened, you would have no desire at all to be in the Word of God, and you'd probably be cursing God out and stuff like that. But again, the hardening comes from disobedience. Is that God graciously has, think about it. If God's Holy Spirit stops working, you can't come. But if God's been graciously coming at someone, and the person just says, you know, skip you, and God says, you know what, no problem, here. Just like he did to the Gentiles, I'll give you what you want. You want to be immoral? You want to do this? There you go. To the 10th power. Have fun. And again, but does God do that ultimately for the destruction? No. Even when he does that, again, it's because he's hoping that the punishment and stuff will lead them back to salvation. Mm-hmm. Like Paul does in 1 Corinthians 5, where he talks about the man who was sleeping with his stepmother.
Yeah.
And he says, cast him out so Satan will have him. Why? So then he'll come to his senses and repent and come back. The ultimate purpose is still salvation. Now, if they don't, then of course it's condemnation.
Yeah.
Is that God gave you the chance to repent and you wouldn't do it.
Oh, so in the case, like, if somebody's just like, I'm thinking now, somebody wants to, like, get out of Christian, and they're like, oh, watch, I'm going to read this Bible now to prove them wrong on what they think. As they're spending time in the Word, that could be, like, a time when, like, so their hearts were hardened because they're just like, Christians are obviously wrong. They're just crazy, you know? But I'm going to prove them wrong. And so it would be, like, I can see, like, wouldn't that be a time where it's, like, their hearts, that the Lord relents while they're reading the Word, and then they're going to start seeing, it's like, okay, they're not that crazy. Mm-hmm. This yeah. is making sense. And then mm-hmm. that's how they come to salvation. And, like, I see, like,
but again, that
makes
has
a
to
purpose.
Have,
like,
that has to have a purpose.
Yeah.
And it comes from disobedience.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not, I don't think, again, that God just hardens randomly. It's because the person is rebelling against yeah. God. Yes, that God can do that, of course. This is what he does to Israel.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to send you a spirit of stupor. You know, you want to do, you know, when he tells through Isaiah, you know, go tell them, and having eyes they will not see, and having ears they will not hear. Why? Because first he tells them, look at these rebellious people. All day long I stretch out my arms to you. All day long I'm trying to get to, and they don't listen to me. But I'm sending you. You know what I'm sending you to do, Isaiah? To confirm my condemnation of them. That they're going to go into exile. And now you're going to be the nail that's going to be hammered in their coffin. And they are going to go into exile. But when they go into exile, then they'll call back on me. And then I will hear them. But he knows already what they're doing. So now he's going to make sure that he sets them into their condemnation. One of the things that's hard for us is that we hate to think that God is actively involved in these things. But there, I think in some cases it's hard to get away from it. like the hardening, it sounds like, yeah, God is actively involved in doing this. When the Spirit comes upon Israel, yeah, God is actively involved. It's not like God says, oh, you know, oh my goodness, I didn't see that coming. No, God allows that Spirit. God sends it. Now, is God evil? Of course not. But he allows it because, again, what is Saul doing? It's not because Saul is a good person and doing all the right things. Saul continues to violate the laws of God. He continues to break the covenant with God. And God says, enough. You know? And the Spirit of God leaves him. And then the evil spirit comes to him.
Okay, so then it would be wrong to say that it's just that just because a person is disobedient, their heart is hardened. That's mm-hmm. not accurate, right?
No.
Okay.
No.
So it could be disobedience. Disobedience is just that its yeah. own. It's just disobedience.
It's just disobedience to the grace of God coming to him. But it could come to a point where, yes, then God intervenes in a way where he does judge them. Okay. He does break them down. Any questions? All right, let's see how much of the next section we can tackle. We'll do step by step. Rose, would you read chapter 11, verse 11 and 12?
Again, I ask, did they stumble so as to fall beyond recovery? Not at all. Rather, because of their transgression, salvation has come to the Gentiles to make Israel envious. But if their transgression means riches for the world, and their loss means riches for the Gentiles, how much greater riches will their fullness bring?
Amen. And that's the new NIV, huh? Their fullness bring. They finally changed it. You know, because if you ever have a chance, pick up a 1984 NIV, and you see how people, just the theology, man, it's just being read into it. It says their full inclusion will be, you know. So making it sound like, again, it's like end time, all Jews will be saved at the end type thing, rather than what it really reads in the Greek. So sometimes when you see me correct this, and I'm correcting the 1984 edition of the NIV. Again, any questions? Yeah.
Mine says God's offer of salvation, from 12. Now, if the Gentiles were enriched because the people of Israel turned down God's offer of salvation, think how much greater a blessing the world will share when they finally accept it. The world, to me, world, like when I hear things like world and Gentiles and Jews, like world to me is non-believer.
Yeah,
is
but
that what this is
talking about? No, they're turning it around. They turned around the phrase. See, in the NIV it says, but if their transgression means riches for the world, which of course, their sinning against God brought salvation to Gentiles.
So the world is an unbeliever.
But they've actually twisted those phrases backwards. Like somehow the blessing is going to come after they come back to salvation. Read it again. You'll see it says it's saying it backwards. Read verse 12.
Now, if the Gentiles were enriched because the people of Israel turned down God's offer of salvation, think how much greater a blessing the world will share when they finally accept it.
Okay, maybe. But again, they make it almost sound like after
once
Israel accepts it again, then this fullness comes. But actually, it's the other way around. Paul's saying, because Israel sinned, the riches came to the world in the sense that the gospel has gone to all the Gentiles. And, you know, but that doesn't mean, of course, that there's no other hope for all the other Jews to be saved. But he doesn't mean world in the derogatory sense. Again, this is where it's important to know who we're reading. And this is not John, this is Paul. And Paul doesn't have that, you know. John has a world in, uses world in a negative sense. He also uses it in a positive sense, God so loved the world. He has like five different ways of using the word cosmos. But Paul doesn't have that derogatory sense that John does. You know, when Paul wants to talk derogatory, he says flesh. Yeah.
Okay.
Or the rulers of this world. Okay. Maybe something like that. He'll, you know, the demonic spirits and things like that. Again, any other question? The stumbling of ethnic Israel was the means by which the gospel was opened to the Gentiles. Paul does not view their fall as detrimental. It's not the end. It doesn't mean like, you know, oh my goodness, they had a chance to be saved, they weren't saved, Gentiles saved, now no more Jews can be saved. No, of course not. The gospel message is still there, open to all, to everybody, to Jew and Gentile alike, believer and to all non-believers, no matter who they are.
Are the Jews the prodigal son?
No, they cannot be, but that's the result.
Well, if they repent, if they come back.
No, they can't, because the prodigal son is two Jewish kids, not one Jew and one Gentile.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I always thought when they always referred to Israel as the prodigal son, I'm like, yeah, that's really misusing that parable there. Because it's a Jewish parable by Jesus. He's not talking to Gentiles. It's not Paul writing here. This is Jesus talking. And when he gives a parable, he's talking about, again, abandoning the things of God, Israel leaving the things of God and repenting and coming back. But not, Jew-Gentile distinction.
Okay.
All Jews. He's ministering to Jews.
Okay. That just came
to my mind. No problem. How much greater would there, again, in the Greek, the word inclusion, which is in the old NIV, is not there. It just means fullness. And the word for fullness is the same. Let me tell you how N.T. Wright renders it, first of all. Open your NASB. I'm curious how it does that verse also. N.T. Wright renders it, if their trespass means riches for the world, and their impoverishment means riches for the nations, how much more will their fullness mean? Now, the fullness is the same Greek word that he will use in verse 25, where he says, For I would not, brethren, that you should be ignorant of this mystery, lest you should be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part is happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles comes in. Same Greek word. And in there, we know it means all the Gentiles who are going to be saved. So yes, there's also a fullness, all the Jews who are going to be saved. And simply because there's a remnant now doesn't mean that there's not more coming. That's what Paul says. There is a fullness of Jews, ethnic Jews, just like there's a fullness of Gentiles. Which just simply means all those who will believe. But what does verse 12 say there?
It says, now if their transgression is riches for the world and their failure is riches for the Gentiles, how much more will their fulfillment be?
Fulfillment. Fullness is better. But again, I just want to see if they put the word inclusion. But this is what it's talking about. That again, it's not over for them. Now you'll see why Paul says that. Look at verses 13 and 14. It says, I am talking to you Gentiles, inasmuch as I am apostle Gentiles, I take pride in my ministry, in the hope that I may somehow arouse my own people to envy and save some of them. Paul is speaking to Gentile arrogance. The Gentiles are thinking, you know what, Jews, you had your time. You were great, yeah, you were like, you were so awesome, you're so wonderful, but your time has passed. And now it's our time. And Paul's like, no, their time is not yet past. And on the contrary, he's hoping that through the ministry that he has to Gentiles, he will arouse the jealousy of the Jews. And again, that some will be saved. Notice he says some, not all. Paul's realistic. Paul has no imagery of this end time, all Jews will be saved. He's saying he's still hoping that even through his ministry to the Gentiles, that some. And this is what he says in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 22, where he says, I have become all things to all people, so that by all possible means I might save some. Paul has no idea in his mind that some universal salvation for all Jews, ethnic Jews, or some universal salvation for all Gentiles. He knows that not everyone's going to believe, that some people are going to reject. But his hope is that as he's been ministering to Gentiles and preaching to Gentiles, that his Jewish brethren, according to the flesh, will become jealous, and that they will come and accept Christ as Messiah. Any question? Verse 15, now we're taking it step by step. For if their rejection brought reconciliation to the world, what will their acceptance be but life from the dead? He's saying basically, if by them denying the faith, turning away, has meant reconciliation for the world, their coming back will be like a resurrection because they died. Again, he's going to talk about the grafting. They were taken out, the branches taken out, they died. They don't have the life of God, the life of the Spirit in them. So if they came back, Paul kind of says it would be like celebrating Easter all over again. It would be resurrection. Because here they were dead, they were gone, and now they've come back to life. Yeah, it says, so that will be that kind of idea. And that's actually that's from N.T. Wright, where he says, just think, Paul is saying to Gentile Christians in Rome, once you realize that their casting away was like the death of the Messiah, when they are brought back again, it will be like a little Easter, and you should celebrate. You should be happy. Again, the Gentiles are not happy. The Gentiles are basically, remember, the Jews, they're thrown out of Rome. Now they come back to Rome. Gentiles are like saying, you know what, this is our church now. This is our congregation. We're the leaders. We don't want you guys. And Paul's like, no, 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 you should be so happy. You should be so happy that they've come back. You should be so happy when other Jews come, other ethnic Jews come to know the Lord. This is a good thing. We should still be celebrating their resurrection. Any question? I'll try again. I want to do one more verse, and then next week we'll pick on the. I don't want to get into the root and the branch and stuff like that. That's when we get to the meats and potatoes. Verse 16. If part of the dough offered as first fruits is holy, then the whole batch is holy. If the root is holy, so are the branches. The first of these images depends on the sacrificial tradition of the Feast of Weeks, represented in Numbers chapter 15, verse 20, where it says, of the first of your dough you shall take off, you shall offer up a cake as a heavenly offering. The point being that once the first part of the dough has been offered to God, the entire batch is considered holy, consecrated, and ready for Israel to use. The second imagery they use, the root is holy, that's Paul. That doesn't come from any Old Testament allusion. That's just something that he's using for the analogy that he's going to use about the root and the branches and being plucked out and being grafted in. And what he's saying basically, the first fruits were the Jews who became believers. And they were a promise of all the other believers that were to come, Jew and Gentile alike. But that was the first harvest. So that first group of Christians were Jewish, ethnic Jews. And that was the offering to God. And that was also the promise that the great harvest was coming. And the harvest is not among Jews, but among all people. And we see that right at the beginning when Pentecost breaks forth, the gospel goes everywhere. It's just like wildfire. And not just as Jews, but to everybody. And of course, it takes time for Jews then to adapt to the Gentiles because the Gentiles are ethnically so different from them. But the gospel goes to them, and of course, it goes through them first and foremost through Peter to make sure that he's the one. Because then there's no question, no doubt about their inclusion within the people of God.
So this first fruit that are the Jews, this is saying the disciples?
Yes.
Okay.
They are the first fruits. And all the first and all the believers that met on the day of Pentecost, because obviously it was just not 12. There were many of them.
No, yeah, but I mean no one prior to Christ coming.
No. No, this is all from Christ. And again, the question is, and you know, something to think about next week, and you can look at it. The big discussion is always, who's the root? There's the root, and they talk about the branches. We know the branches is Israel. It's the olive tree. Because the branches are taken out, and the wild olive will be grafted in, which is Gentiles. But who's the root? I don't believe it. Some people say that the root is Israel. I don't think so, because Israel is the branches being plucked down. They'll say it's the patriarch, but to me the patriarchs, again, are branches. Abraham is a branch, not the root. To me, the root is Christ. What he means is that the life-giving root, in the real life of the vine, is Jesus. Jesus as the new Israel. He's the one through whom the people of God are defined. Are you in Christ? Then you're saved. You're not in Christ, you're dead. Now, one thing that's interesting about Paul, when you read the next section, read this next section and read it in correspondence with John 15. Because that's where Jesus says, I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me. But the one distinction that I know is incredible is that Paul doesn't say the branches don't bear fruit, are taken out, and they're cast into the fire and nothing else. He actually used the imagery of the possibility of them being grafted back in. Again, he's only using an illustration. But in his illustration, there's still hope for the branches that were taken out. For the branches that were plucked out, there's still a possibility of being regrafted into the root. But again, read that, and of course prepare yourself, because that's, next week we'll get into that phrase, bless you. We're going to get to that phrase, all Israel will be saved, which is the big key right there. Any questions?